Our next panel, titled Multi-Party Arbitration Issues in International Project Finance Arbitration, will be led by our very own Professor Franco Ferrari. Professor of Law and Director of the Center for Transnational Litigation and Commercial Law, Professor Ferrari received his JD from Bologna University in Italy and his LL.M. from Augsburg University in Germany. He joined the NYU Law School faculty on a full-time basis in September of 2010. Professor Ferrari was chaired Professor of Comparative Law at Tilburg University in the Netherlands and also at Bologna University in Italy. After serving as member of the Italian delegation to various sessions of the United Nations Commission on International Trade Law from 1995 to 2000, he served as legal officer at the UN Office of Legal Affairs in their International Trade Law branch for a 2 to 3 year period from 2000 to 2002. Professor Ferrari has published over 240 law review articles in various languages and 15 books in international commercial law, as well as conflict of laws, comparative law, and international commercial arbitration. Professor Ferrari also acts as an arbitrator in both international commercial arbitration and investment arbitration, and it's a pleasure for us to have him all the way from Europe as a full-time faculty here in our school. So please join me in welcoming Professor Ferrari and our panel.
Thanks. Great, you take all the applause you can and then you run. That's normally what I do, but I'm supposed to say a few words. So now the fun starts. So what we had up to now was just warming up. So we will deal with one of the questions posed by Professor Davis in earlier today when he asked, but do these deals go wrong? We will deal with exactly that session this afternoon. We have five of the most distinguished counsel and arbitrators here today. They will talk about various aspects of project finance and arbitration. Some of the issues to be dealt with, for example, now by our colleague Matthieu de Boisséson, are issues that are arbitration issues as such and arise in a project finance context as well. We will then also have some talks on more project finance specific issues as the afternoon proceeds. Mr. Matthieu de Boisséson is a graduate from Paris University, Sorbonne, in law, but he also holds a PhD in literature, and I'm sure he's the only one on the panel. He sat as an arbitrator in more than 140 cases, whether it's under ICC rules, under LCIA rules, ICSID, and so forth. He is also the co-author of one of the most influential books in French on the French law of arbitration, both domestic and international, a new edition of which we are expecting in 2014. And I give him the floor right away. He will deal with two of the issues I mentioned, meaning arbitration issues in the context of project finance, namely multi-party arbitration and the extension of the arbitration agreement to non-signatories.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to to express my thanks to this kind invitation. I'm extremely pleased to be here at NYU with you. And I would like also to thank particularly Professor Ferrari and all our friends to have organized this session. As you know, the growth of very complex projects, complex contracts, has increased the number of complex arbitration cases. And the ICC in particular has been faced with an enormous increase of complex arbitration over the last past years. In 1998, for instance, only 10% of the arbitration administered by the ICC court were related to multi-party arbitration, and today it's more than 30% of the cases received by the ICC court, which are cases extending beyond the classic bipolar model of arbitration. And this is the reason why the ICC court of arbitration has felt the need to improve its rules and by keeping, of course, the very flexible frame, which is the traditional structure of the ICC rules, but also to render these rules more efficient in order to adapt the rules to these cases of multi-party arbitration, complex cases, multi-contract arbitration cases as well. The new rules were enacted, came into force on the 1st of January 2012, and I would like to describe briefly the main articles which deals with complex arbitration. I use the term complex arbitration because now it is a kind of generic expression, generic wording of these cases, including three main hypotheses. First of all, a first issue, which is multi-party arbitration, where a single contract has been concluded by many parties. A second structure is, especially in project financing, where there are underlying documents and also the banking or financing documents and a series of contracts between the investors, the banks or the loans, etc., and then between the contractors, subcontractors, etc. So the second issue is a group of contracts or contracts interrelated between themselves. And the third main issue is related to contracts, group of contracts, which imply parties which has not necessarily signed these agreements. So this is the three main issues which are at stake in our conversation, and which was of course at stake in the willingness of the ICC Court of Arbitration when she decided to improve the ICC rules. So the first article, which is telling, and it's worth mentioning in the ICC, in the new ICC rule since 2012, is Article 7. Article 7 enables the joinder of additional parties. Before 2012, it was possible for a claimant, for instance, to identify not only the respondent, but other respondents. For instance, respondents which were not signatories, for instance, or respondents which were signatories. But the respondents had difficulty in identifying other parties against which possibly these respondents had possible claims. So now it is open to any party to make a joinder, to submit to the ICC court before the signature of the terms of reference, a request for joinder of additional parties. And this is provided for by Article 7. Article 8 is related to claims between multiple parties. Under Article 1.1, any party to the arbitration, whether a claimant, respondent, or an additional party under Article 7, which I was just mentioned, is entitled to make a claim against any other existing party, which means, for instance, that between the respondents, a respondent 1 may is entitled, within the framework of the ICC rules now, which was not the case before, to submit a claim against respondent 2, not only a counterclaim against a claimant, but also a claim against respondent 2 or respondent 3, or a counterclaim against claimant number 2. And claimant number 1 may possibly make a claim against claimant number 2, which is, of course, something which is far more flexible than before. Article 9 deals with multi-contract arbitration, and it states, I quote, claims arising out or in connection with more than one contract may be made in a single arbitration irrespective of whether such claims are made under one or more than one arbitration agreement under the rules. So in order to proceed with a sole arbitration proceedings based on various agreements, this is the hypothesis of several agreements, a claim may be presented on the basis of multiple contracts and multiple arbitration agreements. Of course, there will be a checking made by the Secretariat of the ICC Courts, and there are two main hypotheses in that. If all the parties are participating and there are no objections, the Secretariat will transmit the case file to the arbitral tribunal without requesting a prior decision from the court. And if there is one or more of the parties which are not participating in the arbitration object to the claim being heard together in a single arbitration, the matter will be referred to the court by the Secretariat. So you see that this this article 9, 5 minutes remaining. This article 9 is equally interesting. Article 5, consolidation of arbitration. The consolidation arbitration is a merger between pending arbitration. And before 2012, it was only possible when it was the pending arbitrations were existing between the same parties. So now the courts may consolidate in three situations: when there is an explicit agreement of all the parties in all of the arbitrations to be consolidated, when there is an agreement, this is very simple; where all the claims in the different arbitration second case are made under the same arbitration agreement, and in that case the court may consolidate arbitrations even if the parties to the arbitration are not the same, which is the main difference; where the claims in the arbitration arise under more than one arbitration agreement, if, first, the arbitration are between the same parties; second, the disputes in the arbitration arise in connection with the same legal relationship; and third, the court finds the arbitration agreements to be compatible. So this is, we might expand later because I have not much time left, this hypothesis, but we see that the new ICC rules have expanded the scope of the possibility to consolidate, but at the same time doing its best to respect the will, the intent of the parties. And I would like to finish this brief description, maybe we may come back later about that, with the topic of extension of the arbitration agreement to non-signatories parties. As you know, the word extension is extremely misleading because it's not a question of extend the legal effect of an arbitration agreement. The question is to identify the parties to an arbitration agreement. This is the problem. Whether the parties are signatories, when they are signatories, it is easy. When they are non-signatories, it is a little more difficult. There are a certain number, of course, of hypotheses: transmission of the arbitration agreement, subrogation, and novation, settlement, etc. But there is also other cases, among others, you know some of them. For instance, the jurisprudence about the group of companies, which is prevailing in certain countries, especially in Europe, when a mother company, for instance, or a subsidiary, although not a signatory, has closely participated to the conclusion or to the performance of the agreement, the arbitral tribunal may decide that this party, within the structure of the group of company, either a mother company or subsidiary, should be considered as a party to the arbitration agreement and consequently should proceed, we should participate to the procedures, to the famous Dow Chemical case and many other decisions which have been rendered, but certainly we will have the opportunity to revert to that. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this account, where one can see, of course, a conflict between keeping the role of party autonomy where it is today and grouping either claims or disputes or parties. That requires obviously a rather careful drafting of the arbitration agreement, which is what in part our next speaker will talk about, Ms. Hanefeld. Actually, Dr. Hanefeld, who got an incredible CV, as you can see. She is a managing partner of her own law firm. Her fame to claim is not only to have been an LLM student here at NYU, but she was a fellow last year at the Center for Transnational Litigation and Commercial Law. She has worked for 7 years in a major law firm in their Vienna offices, New York offices, Frankfurt and Hamburg offices, but finally settled in her own place in Hamburg. Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Franco, and the conference organizers for having invited me to this panel. And thank you very much, Matthieu, for your valuable overview on multi-party arbitration under the ICC rules. I will now add my German accent to the topic. I learned this morning that it's called Project Finance, but I will say Project Finance, and I think today I will not manage to correct my pronouncement.
And you will actually not be the only one.
Italians do the same. Yes, I will continue to share with you some thoughts on choosing the right arbitral institution and drafting arbitration agreements in project finance settings. The question which I asked me, or which guided my thoughts when I prepared for today, is to what extent can arbitration agreements in project finance settings be inclusive, i.e. be valid for all disputes, for all contracts, for all questions among all parties to the project? And to what extent should arbitration agreements be exclusive, i.e. exempt matters from the arbitral tribunal's jurisdiction and outsource these tasks to external service providers such as valuation experts? I think we can agree as a starting point on this panel, or hopefully we agree, that there has been a move towards the adoption of arbitration clauses, at least in international project finance transactions, even if the financial world is sometimes still reluctant to include these clauses in their contracts. And I think it would also be interesting to discuss in the course of this panel, and I can't mention this pile of agreements which form part of such a project finance transaction, for which contracts exactly arbitration is really the suitable means of last resort. But maybe we come to this later. I will now turn to the arbitration agreement, as Franco has promised. And so now let's think what to consider when drafting such an agreement. Unlike in investor-state arbitration under multilateral or bilateral investment treaties, as in common arbitral practice, in project finance arbitration, you will need a valid contractual arbitration agreement in order to establish a tribunal's jurisdiction. So the bilateral investment treaties between the investor and the host state of the investment or the project does not make the contractual arbitration agreement obsolete, because actually it's the contractual arbitration agreement which is tailored to the specific needs of the project. As concerns the arbitral institution, which should ideally be determined in the arbitration agreement, there are prestigious arbitral institutions with a general mandate for dispute resolution, such as the already mentioned ICC International Court of Arbitration. However, recently, specialized institutions have emerged with an exclusive mandate for the settling of financial disputes. The most recent example is Prime Finance, Prime standing for Panel of Recognized International Market Experts. This is a specialized institution with an exclusive mandate for the resolution of financial disputes. It was founded in 2012, has its seat in The Hague, and the rules are a modified version of the UNCITRAL rules. It will be interesting to see whether the other panelists have already practical experience and are with these rules. I only wish to flag out certain particular aspects of these rules. First of all and foremost, the selection of arbitrators under these prime finance rules is narrowed down to an approved list of arbitrators. So you have not the free choice to appoint your arbitrator, but only someone from the list. If multiple parties on claimants or respondents' side are parties to the dispute, it gets even narrower. Multiple parties have to appoint their arbitrator jointly from this list. These prime finance rules also allow for a third person rejoinder, but only in very limited circumstances if the third person is party to the arbitration agreement and unless the tribunal finds that the joinder should not be permitted because of prejudice to any of those parties. What the prime finance rules do not include are any specific regulations for cases where a state is party to the arbitration. Also an interesting particularity is the somehow limited scope of confidentiality. The rules want to support the idea of increased publication of arbitral awards. And also worth noting is that the rules grant the tribunal extensive means to grant interim relief. Are these rules now suitable for project finance transactions? I have no final view on this, but I think it will certainly be very interesting to see whether the financial world and the project finance lawyer perceive the arbitrators listed by Prime Finance as having the necessary project finance expertise. In particular, I think if it gets complicated if it gets to disputes with host states where, for example, also experience concerning the law of bilateral investment treaties, political risk insurance, etc. is concerned. So it will be very interesting to see how the caseload of this new institution will develop and what the views here in the audience on these rules are. If we turn to the drafting of the arbitration agreement, this is certainly a very sophisticated task. I understand that the project finance lawyers delegate this task to the dispute resolution departments. I will just mention a couple of things. The model clauses by the arbitral institutions are certainly a very good starting point when drafting an arbitration agreement. One will have to think about the place of arbitration, language of the proceedings, applicable substantive law, confidentiality, and finally, very importantly, absent provisions in the rules, like in the ICC rules, the parties will have to be to think about the multi-party, multi-contract scenarios which arise in project finance arbitration. So they have to think to use complementary arbitration clauses, and in addition, they have to confer explicit powers of joiner and consolidation on the arbitrators if this is not already foreseen in the rules. This sophistication in drafting has certainly no limits. In our complex projects, you will find also multi-step clauses, assisted negotiation, conciliation, mediation, and the like. But it would go too far to go into the very details of this drafting technique. I rather proceed with the second part of my presentation, I have 5 minutes left, or four, but I will manage. I now want to turn to the part which I am titled Exclusion or Outsourcing of Certain Tasks to other Service Providers. What do I mean with outsourcing? I mean carving out a certain aspect from the arbitration agreement and the jurisdiction of the tribunal, in particular for the subject valuation. I know Mark Hunter is the true expert on this. I have read a lot about it, which bears your signature. maybe we'll discuss it later. In my practice as arbitrator and counsel, I have witnessed so far two alternative methods of outsourcing valuation and project finance and our settings to external service providers. The first is the appointment of an expert by the arbitral tribunal, and the second is the conduct of valuation proceedings exclusively and by party appointed experts. I perceive the first method, that the arbitral tribunal appoints an expert once a dispute has arisen, as the traditional method in our project finance. This method applies in situations where the parties have not agreed on an expert, but where the arbitral tribunal sees the need for the outsourcing of valuation. In project finance scenarios, this very often comes into play because you have to, for example, quantify damages and assess the prospective revenues of a certain project. In most recent development, and it seems to me the trend to carve out this topic completely and get it out of the tribunal's jurisdiction. I think of a valuation clause in an infrastructure project finance arbitration in which I act as counsel, and there is contractual setting which I thought might be of interest for you. There the fair market value is to be certified in writing by an independent expert, having regard to all normal valuation factors which are considered relevant, in his absolute discretion, including the following matters. Then it gets very technical and mathematical. And the following rules shall apply with respect to the appointment of the expert. One side shall propose an independent expert whom the other side may accept at his sole discretion. If the other side accepts the independent expert, he will establish within a certain period of time an expert report, and the valuation of the expert shall be binding and conclusive. In the event the other party does not accept the expert, it will also present its expert report. Both sides will share the results of the valuation, and then the following thing will happen. In the event the difference between the valuation established by the two experts is less than 10%, then the arithmetic method will govern. If the difference is greater than the 10%, then the two independent experts shall appoint a third independent expert, and this third independent expert will make a final valuation, which shall fall between the valuations established by the two independent experts. And now comes the most interesting part as an arbitration lawyer, the decision of the independent experts appointed pursuant to the rules set out herein shall be final, without appeal, and binding upon the parties who shall conform thereto. I think this is an interesting scenario, I like it as counsel and as arbitrator, because I think that valuation in such a complex project is too complex to drag it into the arbitration unless this is definitely required. So if, as in my case, one wants to take it out of the arbitration, particular care is again required in drafting the contractual arrangements. An initial problem often results from the fact that the parties are not clear whether the result of the expert determination shall be binding or not, so the wording must be precise. Second, parties often fail to stipulate clearly for whom the outcome of the valuation shall be binding, for all project participants or only to certain parties. And third, parties sometimes fail to stipulate to what extent the valuation proceeding shall be binding. Just take the example of determining the valuation date. In some instances, this may predominantly be a task to be performed by the tribunal, if it presupposes a prior determination of an event of default or the like. Yes, this list, and that to consider and what to include or what to exclude in the arbitration agreement and project findings could be, I think, continued for a little bit longer. But my time is over, and adhering to the promise to honor Ferrari speed time limit of 10 minutes, it's my pleasure to hand over to Mark Kantor.
Oh, thank you very much. Obviously, even this issue of multi-party arbitration somehow depends on the drafting. We will also, when I said earlier, we will deal with various issues. There is obviously no seminar on project finance that can avoid talking about investment arbitration. We are lucky to have Mark Kantor here today. Mark Kantor, as all of you know, is an adjunct professor at Georgetown University Law Center. He was partner in the corporate and project finance groups of Milbank, Tweed, Hadley, and McCloy for years. He is a senior research fellow at an institute uptown, Vale Center for Sustainable International Investment. Well, I don't know where that is. Mr. Kantor is also very well known, of course, for him being the editor-in-chief of Transnational Dispute Management. He is the author of the book already evoked earlier, Valuation for Arbitration, Compensation Standards, Valuation Methods, and Expert Evidence. And he also has, at this point, 12 minutes.
Thank you, Franco, for that very gracious introduction, which I wrote. and I, in addition to thanking you, I would also like to thank NYU and the Journal of Law and Business for inviting me here. And I must admit, particularly Jesse and Jonathan, who've been really great to me over the last several weeks, I'd like to thank you personally in front of everybody. special mention before I do anything substantive to Professor Andy Lowenfeld, who is not here, but of course is a long-standing fixture here at NYU. Andy was the professor for whom my wife worked when she was a law student here at NYU, and she survived him, so I'm sure all of you can as well. Given the now 11 and a half minutes I have left, I will be brief. Contrary to Inka's hope, I'm not going to focus on valuation experts or damages, although we can return to that in the question and answer, because I didn't prepare for that today. I instead will address two questions. Is investment arbitration like a guarantee? And is political risk insurance sufficient so that investment arbitration is just not needed? The answer to both questions is no. The reason for asking those questions in a conference on project finance is that political risk insurance is a common feature in international project finance, equity political risk insurance, and debt political risk insurance. And investment arbitration is an increasing aspect of both counseling and dispute resolution for infrastructure projects that have gone wrong. Now, nothing that I say about political risk insurance is candidly going to be a surprise to the project finance practitioners in the room, certainly not to the people who are on the immediately preceding panel. And nothing that I say about investment treaty arbitration will be a surprise to the investment treaty practitioners in this room, and certainly not to the people on this panel. But it may be a surprise to those who are reflexively anti-investment treaty voices in NGOs or in academia or in government. And it may be a surprise to students who are just learning about these topics and look to people who are practitioners and scholars to try to understand these issues better. The first point I'd like to turn to is whether or not investment treaty arbitration is like a guarantee, because we see that phrase tossed around a lot in NGO critiques of investment arbitration. Well, if you had a contract that provided that the disputing parties submitted their dispute to the jurisdiction of the U.S. District Court for the Southern District of New York, or the Commercial Court in London, or the High Court in Delhi, no one would think that was a guarantee. That's a selection of a forum to hear a dispute. And if that contract further said, this contract shall be governed by and construed in accordance with the law of the state of New York or of England, or of India, that would not be a guarantee either. That just identifies the applicable rules to which we refer when we consider the conduct of the parties. Well, an investment treaty dispute is not terribly dissimilar. You specify a forum, a type of international arbitration, and you specify a very limited set of rules. They're set out in the investment treaty itself. And in general, they say no expropriation without compensation. Thou shalt not breach the international minimum standard, fair and equitable treatment, denial of justice, full protection and security. Thou shalt not discriminate against a foreigner in favor of another foreigner, most favored nation treatment. Thou shalt not discriminate against a foreigner in favor of locals, national treatment. Those are the core promises and the core legal rules in an investment treaty. Some investment treaties also provide thou shalt not break your promises, a so-called umbrella clause, and the extent to which that picks up breach of contract claims is highly controversial. In general, though, if the government is acting in a commercial capacity, most arbitrators so far have concluded that there is no breach of contract claim available in investment treaty arbitration under an umbrella clause. That's a controversial issue. In effect, what investment treaty arbitration does is it provides a forum and a limited set of rules. That is not a guarantee. In fact, it isn't even close to a guarantee when we look at what actually happens. When we look at the outcome of investment treaty arbitrations, governments win more than half the time. High quality governance countries almost never lose. The United States has never lost an investment treaty arbitration. Britain, Germany, Belgium, the Netherlands have never lost. Canada has lost 2.5 arbitrations. They're the only good governance country that has ever lost an investment treaty arbitration. The countries that lose investment treaty arbitrations are usually countries that are transitional governments, countries rather, or they are countries that have poor records of governance. When I say win and lose, by the way, you should appreciate if the tribunal awards even a penny to the investor, that's a win, the way I just calculated numbers. Investors, in general, in the last few years, when they win, which is less than half the time, they are awarded around 20% of what they have asked for. And then, of course, they have to take that piece of paper, the award, and turn it into money, unless the government voluntarily pays that award. And if you happen to have watched what Argentina and Ecuador, among others, are doing, you will know that neither of those countries has paid any of their recent investment treaty awards. It's very hard to collect if the government is recalcitrant. So the one thing investment treaty arbitration is not is a guarantee. Now let me turn to the second topic. Does the existence of political risk insurance mean that I have only 5 minutes remaining? Yes, it does. In addition to that, does the existence of political risk insurance mean that we don't need investment treaty arbitration? Well, the answer to that is also no. Let me start off first by pointing out that political risk insurance is only purchased in somewhere between 10 and 15% of foreign direct investment transactions, according to MIGA, Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency, and other surveys of private and official political risk insurers. That means 85 to 90% of the foreign direct investment transactions in the world go forward without political risk insurance. Why is that? Well, there are two core reasons. First, this stuff costs a lot. And second, political risk insurance is not a guarantee either. It is a narrow scope of cover. It is subject to limits, to conditions, and to qualifications. In the remaining few minutes I have, let me explain very quickly what I mean. Hypothetically, if you had a small to medium-sized power project internationally, you might see $100 million of equity invested and $300 to $400 million of debt invested. The cost of a power project of 140 megawatts is somewhere between $400 and $500 million. That is the example I use, by the way, in the class I teach at Georgetown. So let's take the $100 million equity and ignore completely the $300 to $400 million of debt. How much does it cost to purchase political risk insurance for $100 million of equity? Well, fortunately for us, the US agency, OPIC, publishes a set of rate schedules. And if you take their rate schedules and just use the mid-range, because it obviously depends on how risky the country is, and you purchased expropriation cover, political violence cover, and inconvertibility cover, which are the three principal scopes of cover, the cost of that insurance for $100 million would be $1,070,000 per year, payable up front, annually in advance. What does that mean? Well, let's say we complete the project tomorrow, Franco, and 5 years later, Ruritania expropriates the project. 5 years worth of insurance, in that example, is $5,350,000. That's more money than I have in my bank account. And that's for a power project. An oil and gas project is even more expensive. Same $100 million, good luck finding an oil project for only $100 million of equity, by the way. Same $100 million, the cost of the political risk insurance over 5 years would be somewhere between $11 and $14 million for an oil and gas project. This is expensive stuff. What do you get for it? That's the second point. Well, the first thing I've already indicated, political risk insurance does not cover all types of political risk. It covers expropriation, direct or indirect. They will cover political violence, war, insurrection, strife, terrorist attacks. It will cover transferability and inconvertibility restrictions, debt moratoriums. And in some limited circumstances, it will cover breach of contract by a state party. Okay. What doesn't it cover? Well, the single most common successful claim in investment treaty arbitration is breach of fair and equitable treatment. It's not covered under political risk insurance. Period. Just isn't. Not unless it turns into an expropriation. In addition, there are limits, dollar limits. OPIC, for example, like most official credit insurers, requires the investor share 10% of any loss. 90% OPIC pays, 10%. So right there, you've got 10% for the insurer, for the insured, the investor. But there's a ceiling also. OPIC has a ceiling right now of 270% of the size of the equity. Mika has a ceiling of $220 million. You remember that power project that I mentioned was 140 megawatts? That was $494 million of invested capital. Got a problem there, don't you? In addition to that, when you calculate the sum that the insurance company pays, it's based on book value, not market value. As any accountant or financial valuation expert in this room will say, market value of an operating successful project is always higher than book value, which means that if there's any excess of market value over book value, the insurance doesn't cover it. And then, in the 1 minute remaining, I will draw your attention to limitations and qualifications. You have a duty to disclose events that may give rise to a loss. If you don't do that, the insurance goes away. You have the possibility of multiple causes. And if the preponderant source of the loss is not a covered event, the whole policy might go away under some policies. You have situations where the investor is alleged to have engaged in provocative acts. There's an exclusion in most political risk insurance policies for provocative acts by the insurer. And finally, the last point I'd like to make is some people think that when an insurance company pays political risk insurance, that means the government doesn't have to pay. That is wrong. In addition to the 10% the investor still has, and anything above the ceiling, and anything that's market value in excess of book value, every penny the insurer pays to the investor, the insurer is subrogated to the claim of the investor and gets to pursue the host state to recover what they paid. And by the way, that's what the MIGA convention says. That's what bilateral agreements between MIGA and the host state say. That's what bilateral agreements between OPIC and the host state say. And if you don't think insurers really do that, you should pick up the phone and call the government of India and ask them why the United States government sued them in connection with the Dabhol project. Or perhaps you could call the government of Indonesia and ask them about what the US government did in the Patuha and Himperna projects after they paid their insurance, or what the private insurers did in the Garaha Bodas project. And with my time now up, I'd like to thank you for your patience.
Thank you very much, Mark. And to the audience, I suggest really you read the account that the organizers have made available up front on international project finance and arbitration by Mark Kant in the Fordham International Law Journal, because it is a tale of, I quote, bribes, kickbacks, and corruption, the collapse of entire economies, wholesale rejection of contracts, political crisis and coups, claim of human rights violations, injunctions against arbitration, and God forbid, awards in the hundreds of millions of US dollars. It is made available. From investment arbitration to actually what international commercial arbitration can do, given the limitations of international investment treaty arbitration, and it is Ryan Reetz who will tackle the topic. He is a partner in DLA Piper's International Arbitration and Litigation Practice. His practice specifically ranges from investment disputes and sovereign immunity challenges to class actions, RICO Act claims, contract disputes, unfair trade practices, and so on. He taught for 8 years transnational civil litigation arbitration as an adjunct professor at the University of Miami and is now a visiting professor at the University of Nevada School of Law. Please, Ryan.
Thank you, Professor Ferrari, for that very kind introduction, and thank you to the journal for organizing this symposium and for the invitation to be here. It's really wonderful. In thinking about the topics that we've been talking about today, I'm reminded of the story of a businessman who was interested in starting a greenfield project and went up in a hot air balloon to get a better view of the terrain. And some wind came along, blew him off course. He was lost, floating above the earth, looked down, saw someone standing in a field and said, "Hello, please, can you help me? Can you tell me where I am?" And the man standing in a field said, "Yes, of course. You're in a hot air balloon. You're about 45 feet above the earth." The man in the balloon said, "You must be a lawyer. How did you know? Your answer was completely accurate and completely useless." And I think the subject of utility is very important when we talk about remedies and disputes that arise in the context of these projects. Mark sold me on never buying political risk insurance for anything and made a very eloquent case for the limited usefulness of investor state arbitration, investment treaty arbitration, really. And that ties in with what Inka said about the BITs not rendering commercial arbitration or an arbitration agreement obsolete. And I wanted to just take a few minutes to talk about the relative utilities of the two mechanisms, when one can be helpful and when another can be helpful, and to suggest that we need both of them really for many of these projects to make sense in terms of having available remedies. What is one of the big problems with investor state arbitration? You have to have a claim that falls within its parameters, which means this isn't going to be a claim against anyone other than a state that's a party to one or two treaties that are necessary to select the venue, as Mark suggested, and to select the applicable law to give rights. And you have to meet the jurisdictional requirements with respect to those claims. So you need, in addition to a claim against a contracting state and a treaty, the claimant needs to be a national of another contracting state. When you have a project ownership structure that maybe has a local entity as the ground level operating entity, and then it's owned by foreign entities, you may run into issues about whether you have someone who can make a claim, someone that is a national of another contracting state. And this is an issue that may not be resolved until the time of arbitration. So there's uncertainty as to whether you may be able to make an investor state claim given a particular company structure. Another ground of uncertainty is whether you have what's described as an investment. An investment is something necessary to have jurisdiction in the ICSID regime of investor state arbitration, but it's also something you have to have to claim under a bilateral investment treaty, whether or not you're going to use the ICSID scheme. And there are differing definitions of investments, and until you have an arbitral tribunal that decides which one will be used, there's further uncertainty as to whether you really will have an investor state remedy. The claim that you would assert would be a claim against the state for something it did, an expropriation, a violation of fair and equitable treatment, or denial of national treatment, or something like that. Many of the commercial complaints that you might have, even against a state entity, won't qualify, as Mark suggested. And the claims that arise in the context of investor state arbitration are typically claims of international law, either treaty-based claims or perhaps claims under conventional, under customary international law. But there's also uncertainty as to exactly how that will all play out in the context of an investor state arbitration, in part because it's a regime that is not based on a comprehensive articulation of standards as in a code-based regime, nor is it based on a developed system of precedent. So that arbitral tribunals really have a tremendous amount of freedom to decide each case according to their own understanding of their responsibilities. Another potential limitation of the utility of investor state arbitrations is the very lengthy pre-arbitration requirements, whether it's a cooling off period or a negotiation period that must be complied with before you can commence the arbitration. And there may be ways to dispense with these requirements, to argue that they're futile or that the state's not going to, or that they're non-jurisdictional. But again, you won't know whether that works, whether you can dispense with the requirement until you have an arbitral tribunal and they rule on the issue. So in general, there's a lot of uncertainty as to how an investor state claim will come out, which is why, as Mark suggested, only a small percentage of them are viewed as successful by the investors who bring them. Other potential limits to investment treaty arbitration include the subject of multiple parties, something that Matthieu talked about, which works to some extent now in the commercial arbitration context. There are ways of handling claims among multiple parties that it's very difficult in investor state arbitration to bring in multiple parties. About the only thing that I've seen is a possibility under NAFTA of consolidating like claims under certain circumstances. But you cannot have the sort of complex multi-contract, multi-party arbitration that you can allow for in the context of commercial arbitration. Mark mentioned that the measure of damages is generally more conservative in investor state arbitrations, and provisional measures are much more restricted in their being granted. Why do we see all these limitations? The whole idea behind the bilateral investment treaty regime was to encourage foreign investment by providing comfort to investors, by trying to make investors feel secure. And yet we see that in application, the rights conferred by the treaties and the procedures don't seem to provide all that much. And one answer may be that when you provide these rights by treaty, you're using a very broad instrument. You're conferring rights on a very broad category of potential investors. And it may be that countries are more comfortable conferring rights in an individual basis in the context of a particular contract or project that they may want than committing very far in advance to all potential investors who may fit within the regime. So the limitations, I think, tell us that in terms of bargaining, even with just the state, the host state, you may be able to accomplish much more in the context of commercial arbitration. But commercial arbitration has its own limits that render it inappropriate for some situations. You have the question of non-signatories or whether you have the right contracting party in your arbitration agreement. If the state action that has made the investment infeasible is not an action taken by a contract party, you may have no claim under your contracts and in your commercial context. If there may be an issue if you're contracting with a state party of whether the state party really has the capacity to enter into an arbitration agreement as a matter of its own law, whether it can be held to that arbitration agreement. The applicable legal rules will be rules of contract law, which may not include the sort of international law claims that you would want to assert. And you may have state interference with the arbitration process itself. There are also issues with enforcement under either regime, questions of sovereign immunity on execution of arbitration assets, and the commercial arbitration award is potentially subject to greater interference by being set aside in the jurisdiction of the seat, which it's very difficult to get a state entity to agree to arbitrate with a seat outside of its own territory. I think in deciding between these two types of arbitration with respect to protecting your rights, you should also consider questions of public perception and publicity. The investor state arbitrations tend to have a higher degree of visibility, even though in theory they're supposed to be confidential in many aspects. This publicity with the claim may pressure the state to consider a settlement more actively. On the other hand, as we heard in this afternoon's first panel, publicity about state concessions to private parties may create political pressure and may make it more difficult for the state political actors to resolve the dispute. So that's something that has to be considered. And timing is also very important, something I suspect I will get my own note about in a minute. The perception is that investor state claims can take a very long time to resolve compared to commercial claims. One statistic I read last night is they, as of a few years ago, ICSID claims were taking about 3.5 years to resolve, which seemed even short to me based on some of the ICSID claims that I'd read about. Another consideration is whether it's possible to reserve some claims for litigation, playing a little bit on Inka's point. If you're dealing with a foreign sovereign, that's generally not going to be a good idea. But for the commercial relationships involved in a complex project, there may be claims that are better dealt with in litigation because they need things that only national courts can do. For example, involving title to land may be something that is more easily dealt with by national courts in some systems. So what I'd like to suggest is there are really three types of dispute resolution that need to be considered. They work together. In an ideal world, you would seek to protect your contract rights through commercial arbitration remedies. Maybe even in a complex project, having a master arbitration agreement to which all of the contract parties subscribe through their individual contracts, whether it's an intercreditor agreement, a financing agreement, et cetera. Everyone buys into a common system of arbitration so that an arbitral tribunal can manage the claims effectively. And in addition to seeking to protect contract rights through commercial arbitration, you seek to protect your international law rights, such as they are, recognizing that they're very limited, through investor-state arbitration and making sure that you have structured the investment as best you can to position yourself to take advantage of the bilateral investment treaties, even though they're not a perfect remedy. And thank you very much.
Thank you. I did not even have to flag times. That's amazing. So we have one more speaker this afternoon. Laurence Shaw is a partner with Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher here in New York. He is co-chair of the firm's International Arbitration Practice Group. He has been the lead advocate in a large number of cases under all kinds of rules, UNCITRAL, ICC, Society of Maritime Arbitrators, LCAE, and Cairo Regional Center, but he does not only act as counsel, he also acts as arbitrator under all of those rules. He is the co-author of International Investment Arbitration, and he knows it. he makes it look like he's embarrassed and he's good at it, but he's not. And
he's not embarrassed or he's not good at it?
He's not embarrassed.
Just be clear, Franco.
Of course. And he's also the co-editor of the World Arbitration Reporter. So you want to be on his good side, basically. Please, Larry.
Thank you, Professor Ferrari. I have just a few remarks and about dealing with expert witnesses in project finance arbitrations, and I'll try to do so from a dual perspective as counsel trying to present an effective case and as arbitrator trying to get to a sound decision. Now, as counsel, whether cross-examining an economist or a forensic accountant on valuation of losses or a business executive on marketing prospects of a product or a project manager or engineer on plant production or defects. Where I work, we tell ourselves, focus on assumptions, otherwise you'll get killed because you'll get into the technical expertise sweet spot of the expert. And here, there's a lot of technical expertise about project finance, and I don't want to get killed either. So I'm going to stick with an underlying assumption about the role of an expert witness that many international arbitrators, particularly those trained in non-US legal jurisdictions, seem to have, which is this. It's a shame that the parties could not agree on a tribunal-appointed expert because the party-appointed experts are partisan. And there's an accompanying assumption, which is experts really should agree if they're genuinely engaged in the search for truth in a technical, empirical, scientific area in the same practice community. They should agree. Of course, except they don't agree. Because unless results can be presented to the tribunal without interpretation, the experts have room to diverge about the truth of the situation wholly apart from who is paying them. And in particular, and I'm sure Professor Kantor will have some observations about this, particularly when they're economists forecasting the future, as they are when they do any sort of DCF calculation. And that's inevitably going to have a speculative element. And in doing so, whatever their opinion is in a particular case, if they change it in another case, that's not necessarily because they're bad people. It's because their opinion in one case and in another case is not violating either their training or their settled views on something fundamental. There's just enough room for that opinion to change. And that should come as no surprise to arbitrators because truth arises in an adversarial context in international arbitration. And the adversarial context does not assume that each side's presentation represents the truth. And in fact, in virtually all rules, it is provided that each party shall have a reasonable opportunity of putting its case, and no one believes that that case is the truth or that the expert retained is stating one unalterable truth. The issues in project finance arbitration don't lend themselves in particular to the programmatic application of a discernible state of knowledge, but the arbitration community would like it to be that way. So whether it's the IBA rules on the taking of evidence, Article 5, or the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators Protocol on the use of party-appointed expert witnesses, they strive to make experts neutral. And they have a provision about the expert should put in his or her report, my overriding duty is to the tribunal. I'm giving you my complete opinion, taking into account all matters that might adversely affect it. And I'm going to meet and confer, or arbitrators require that the experts meet and confer to narrow their differences. The final point is one of interest, and I'll come back to in the 5 minutes I have remaining. But the rest is boilerplate. And in non-US jurisdictions, it may be a belief that there is that experts coming from those jurisdictions are more neutral. Some people here can speak to it. I've seen absolutely no evidence of it. Certainly, however, there are some experts in North American jurisdictions who are getting the point I had one recently who, after being cross-examined, instead of going to the table with us, he went to the back of the room, and I asked him afterwards, and he said, you know, to give the impression of neutrality. I said, I'm sure those three guys sitting up there who don't realize that you've been working with us for 2 years and that very strident view that you gave was not affected at all by the side whose table you were not sitting on. Partisanship is inherent, and therefore my suggestion in the remaining minutes is that the bad fact of partisanship should be embraced. And in fact, when arbitrators and counsel are doing it right, they do embrace it, because it's put in the context of what the tribunal is trying to get from the quantum expert or the project manager, and that is a technical method or trade knowledge applied to assist to understand a fact or matter that is at issue in the case. And then the question is, for the tribunal and what counsel should be assisting on, is who and what are you going to rely on? And I'll just say one word about the investment treaty context. I believe you've heard a slightly partial view. I would recommend, as I always do, the late Professor Brownlee's separate opinion in CME versus Czech Republic, where he very painstakingly goes through a DCF analysis, shows that the speculative aspects should maybe not be accepted in a treaty context, where, after all, the respondent is a sovereign state, not a commercial entity. The sovereign state is not accepting the risk of national economic disaster. And indeed, the statistics that you've heard overlook the fact that the sovereign state doesn't know from the beginning that it's got a 50% chance or whether good governance has been applied or not. All it knows is that there are some terrible awards out there, and if it gets hit, its own citizens' tax rate will rise, as happened to everyone in the Czech Republic after that $335 million DCF analysis was accepted by two-thirds of the tribunal. So what do you want to do with, as counsel and as arbitrator? One, I think maybe not so much from a U.S. perspective, but you want to look at the qualifications of the expert. Is there someone in front of you or someone you're presenting who really does have expertise as an economist, who really does have the right expertise as a project manager in the particular case? You want to get away from the idea that the expert is not engaged with the treaty or the contract. Of course, the expert's job is not to interpret the treaty or the contract, but of course, every single one of them must do so in order to come up with something that is plausible for the tribunal, assisted by counsel or not. And finally, and this is the point that I raised before about meet and confer, both as counsel and surely as tribunal, meet and confer is a good thing. It has the international presumption that reasonable experts should narrow their differences. But of course, what happens in that process is usually one expert who wasn't so reasonable moves $300 million, and another expert moves something much smaller on a much smaller issue. And the tribunal is just very pleased because there's been a narrowing of differences. But they still have to rely principally on one of those experts. And they should be cognizant. And as counsel, I think we should all be cognizant of who moved and who didn't. And that's because it's all in the adversarial context. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much. Actually, apart from everything else, he's an expert timekeeper. So that was really quick. We have 20 more minutes to take questions. However, I have rules even for the questions. Questions are no monologues. Questions are questions. I would also like you to address them to one of the colleagues. That makes it possible to answer more questions. That said, the rules said you can ask questions.
Franco, if you are too restrictive, no one dares to ask.
We don't want monologues, yes.
I have a question.
You have, however, to speak up unless you get a microphone. Thank you very much.
I have a question to Mike Kantor that relates to both investor-state arbitration and political risk insurance. Now, it would appear that in practice these two are linked. That is to say, you have an arbitration clause in the investor agreement, and you also possibly, in addition, have political risk insurance. Given the limitation language that you talked about with respect to political risk insurance, it would appear that these kinds of insurance contracts are dispute-prone or conflict-prone. So what is the dispute resolution mechanism that is in place with respect to disputes arising out of political risk insurance? And the second part of the question, how does that dispute resolution mechanism relate to the dispute resolution mechanism under the investor state agreement? Because it would appear that there might be a conflict between the dispute resolution systems that are operating in practice, and can these be linked somehow in practice?
First, it is market practice in political risk insurance policies and guarantees to provide that disputes between the insurer and the insured are resolved through arbitration. And that arbitration must be confidential, unlike U.S. treaties that provide now for transparent investor-state arbitration, by the way. Okay, and you will find that the decisions made by an insurance company, a claims determination, with one exception, are confidential. And the arbitration awards, if there is a dispute about that claims determination, are confidential, with one exception. The exception is the U.S. government agency OPIC makes publicly available all of its claims determinations and all of the arbitration awards in any dispute in which it is involved. No other political risk insurer does that. The rules that are used in those arbitrations, the OPIC, I say this now as a member of the board of directors of the American Arbitration Association, OPIC wisely chooses the international rules of the American Arbitration Association. MIGA, the arm of the World Bank that issues political risk insurance, wrote their own rules many years ago. They're publicly available, and you can find them, but they're idiosyncratic to MIGA. I do not know the rules that most other insurers use. I'd have to go and check on them. However, they almost never get involved in claims disputes, or so they say. There is one instance, and I'd be curious if anybody knows of any others, where there was a political risk insurance determination, and then there was an investment treaty arbitration. And that is the Ponderosa Enron matter involving Argentina. OPIC paid a claim by Ponderosa under expropriation cover. Enron thereafter asserted basically the same claim. The Ponderosa claim was an Enron claim. Enron asserted the same claim against Argentina investment treaty arbitration. And that was later pursued by Enron's liquidation committee in bankruptcy. And the investment treaty arbitrators expressly said, we do not look to the OPIC determination of expropriation because, of course, that was a national decision. So they just simply ignored the decision by the OPIC, that it was an expropriation. And in fact, I think they concluded in Ponderosa it was not an expropriation, although it was a breach of fair and equitable treatment. That is, I believe, what every single Argentina award has held. No expropriation, but a number of them have concluded there is fair and equitable treatment breach, which goes back to my point that fair and equitable treatment is not within the scope of cover on a standalone basis for political risk insurance. Could you do something with the two? Possibly, but given the very atomized nature of investor-state arbitration, about 3,000 individual treaties plus investment chapters and free trade agreements, it would be very hard to stitch things together without an overriding multilateral investment agreement, and that candidly does not seem in the cards politically.
Great. Do we have some more questions? It wasn't a rhetorical question, so I would like to get an answer. Are there any other questions? I can't imagine that you don't take advantage of the members of the panel.
Let me ask a question.
Perfect.
Larry. You said you're skeptical that party-appointed experts can ever be truly neutral. And that, so my question to you is, when you sit as an arbitrator, which you do, of course, how do you deal with party-appointed experts? What's your tool or tools for trying to get a useful answer out of experts who are insisting that they are impartial, independent, owe their primary duty to the tribunal, but in fact always seem to propose a number that benefits the party who hired them?
Nicely said.
I think part of it is to rely on counsel to expose exactly those assumptions that the expert has made in giving his or her report, and to encourage counsel to explore that. But where they don't, which is partially what happened, I think, in CME, simply because Professor Brownlee came in so late, that the arbitrator himself or herself has to do exactly that examination, and hopefully to have the expert there and to have the experts, both experts from both sides, not in a meet and confer without prejudice situation where they're all going to report back to counsel so they can change their opinions after they've given them up in part, but to have them discuss it in front of the tribunal. But I certainly would probe it deeply and to try to understand it and spend a lot of time on it other than just accept it.
There's a career development point for every student in this room in what you just said, which is that you don't delegate to the expert the question of expertise when you are counsel. But instead, as a lawyer, you have to learn the subject matter on which someone is testifying just as well and possibly better than they know. And those young lawyers who identify an area of expertise, for example, valuation, and learn it well when other lawyers don't know it well, are highly sought after commodity, because there aren't a lot of them who do that. So if you want to develop a reputation early on as a young lawyer in your law firm in the litigation area, working for Larry, for example, understand the subject matter on which the expert is going to testify as well as the expert does, because that's how you challenge assumptions and that's how you engage in vigorous and illuminating cross-examination.
You should take his word for it. He wrote the book Valuation in Arbitration. But there's a comment by Ms. Hanefeld.
Yeah, I think Laurence made a very good point. And I have expert conferencing makes it easier. So if you have made your homework, as Mark suggested, that you truly understand what the questions are, which are determinative for the outcome of the case, and you have this red line in your mind, and then have all expert witnesses together and let them discuss, and you ask them yes and what do you respond, and go back and forth. I think this sometimes is quite helpful to try to get to the truth. Yeah.
We have a question actually from the audience. Yes.
My question concerns the ultimate enforceability of an arbitral award, and I was always interested in the case of CME that the Czech government did not continue to resist, but in fact taxes were raised 30% or more in the subsequent year because they simply did not have the money on hand to satisfy that arbitral award. And I know that countries are signatories to the Convention on the Enforcement of Arbitral Awards and so forth, but I'm wondering in your experience whether it becomes that easy to gain enforcement and satisfaction when a sovereign or an instrumentality of a sovereign is involved. And whether the odds change when the magnitude of the arbitral award is so much greater, or whether there are particular strategies. I recall when I was in practice, one had to craft the arbitration provision extremely carefully to include central bank assets, for example, or aircraft. We tried a case, we were involved in a matter, but in fact the aircraft of this particular government were all sale leaseback craft, and therefore they did not own title to any of those aircraft. So does enforceability create additional challenges, or does one have to go through an additional proceeding, for example, in the jurisdiction where enforcement is sought?
I guess I could speak to that a little bit. Picking up on Mark's point, you could almost say the world is divided into governments that are going to pay the awards and governments that aren't. And there's a reason for that. I mean, beyond the simplistic reduction, the whole idea of the regime of bilateral investment treaties and multilateral investment treaties is that the governments receive something in exchange for the assurances that they're giving, which is that they are hopefully attracting investment and leading to economic development. And if a government becomes known as a government that won't pay its awards, that there's at least a question as to how comfortable foreign investors will feel coming in and doing that. There are other penalties. I mean, in the case of Argentina, the U.S. government has gotten involved to try to put some additional pressure on them. But the specter of losing that additional investment supposedly pressures many governments to pay their awards. I'm kind of a little skeptical about that myself. I think that there's probably a five-year time period during which people forget what happens and they see the opportunity to make money and they think that nothing will ever go wrong again, and they're back into a market where people had problems before. But in theory, if you can find the assets that can be reached consistent with the sovereign immunity law of the country where the assets can be reached, then you can execute on these things, although I haven't heard of anyone successfully doing much. I think there was a German claimant in Europe who got some minor assets, but that's about all that I've heard of being, done through force. I don't know if anyone has had a different experience.
No, so any other questions? We want to see first whether there's somebody else. Yes.
Excuse me. Hi, my name is Elisa. I'm in the LL.M program here in International Legal Studies. I'm Brazilian, so my question relates to Brazil. And it's more as I'm not directing the question to any of the speakers. I would like for any of you who feel more comfortable responding it. As non-Brazilian practitioners in this international investment dynamic and taking, of course, as you know, but just for people who doesn't Brazil, has not enforced any BIT yet, is not planning on being part of the Washington Convention anytime soon, and we still have some troubles with considering the idea of public and private arbitration. As the lecturer of PPP said before, we do have this provision in law, but we don't apply it. So I just wanted to know, how do you see this decision, the government decision of not taking part in this international investment arena? Thank you.
I think it's brilliant. I think it's just fantastic. It was really smart because it doesn't harm Brazilian investors going out. They just restructure their investments through the Netherlands like everyone else, so they're protected, and everyone wants to go to Brazil anyway. So it's just, I just don't understand why more countries don't do it. I was astonished that we have now, is it third generation, fourth generation of Chinese BITs? I just thought that would be certainly one jurisdiction that would do the same as Brazil, but Brazil just seems to have gotten it right, I think. I don't see why they should change. I don't think it's harmed any of their foreign direct investment. Others may know better. And certainly their investors are protected. They've broken the code on the treaty, regime. Say it again.
It's just to say that this technique that Brazilians always find a way of going against the rules to get what you want.
Just so that everybody understands exactly how Brazilian companies doing business outside of Brazil remain protected. If you have a country that is only a capital importer, you don't care about that. But if you have a country that is both a capital importer and a capital exporter, Brazil has grown into that situation, China has grown into that situation, India has grown into that situation. The tension is avoiding having to risk large awards against you from foreign investors with protecting your own investors when they go outside the country and are treated very badly. That's a technical legal rule. It's against international law to be treated badly. The way Brazilian companies have done this since the wave of expropriations in Venezuela, Bolivia, and Ecuador in particular, triggered in part by the Brazil-Bolivia pipeline, is they have restructured their investments so that there is an intermediary company located in a jurisdiction that does have investment treaties. And they've tried to make sure that that intermediary company has enough real business that it's not seen as just a shell corporation that you would look through. And therefore, those companies then rely upon another country's investment treaty arbitrator, investment treaty, to get the protection they need for their outbound investment, while Brazil avoids being sued for any alleged misconduct on its part for inbound investment. The reason why that is not pursued more often, candidly, is that Brazil is not yet a major exporter of capital. When you reach a stage in export of capital where you have so many companies going outside your boundaries and so many different transactions, far too many of them cannot be fit through these havens like the Netherlands Antilles. They instead are just made directly by companies that don't know to go through treaty havens or cannot structure their transaction to go through treaty havens on a commercially reasonable basis. And that's why the Brazilian approach works, but there will be more pressure on Brazil 10, 20 years from now as its economy continues to mature and more of its companies are engaged in globalized transactions where they invest outside the borders of Brazil.
So we have time for a very short question.
What is the dispute settlement body that's typically used for project finance? And I'm a little bit surprised that we spoke so much about MIGA, but we haven't mentioned the WTO's TRIMS agreements, which would cover that. And I'm just curious to know how effective it's been at dispute settlement resolution.
WTO is an entirely different conference, of course, but that's a state-state dispute resolution process and cannot be triggered by individual investors or private companies. So it's not terribly helpful to an individual company or that feels it's been mistreated in connection with a contract or a project. For there is no single one accepted dispute resolution forum in the world of project finance. Lenders typically don't use arbitration. At least international lenders do not. They submit to the New York courts or to the English courts, the London courts. There may be an exception for derivatives transactions where prime is becoming important, but that's because derivatives transactions are not one-sided arrangements. Loans are. The day before I lend you money, I've got the money, you've got nothing. The day after I lend you money, you've got the money, I've got a piece of paper. So my piece of paper is going to be one-sided. We call that a loan agreement. When you get past project finance loan documents to the underlying commercial contracts, the concession agreement, project agreement, in case of developing countries, it's typically arbitration. Which arbitration rules you choose, there's no special rule on that. Same for construction contracts, same for fuel supply contracts. Real estate, as Ryan said, typically is local courts, not arbitration. And letters of credit, standby letters of credit, and commercial letter credits are typically courts again, usually New York or London.
Thank you very much, Mark. So I want to thank, of course, the members of the panel for coming. I want to thank, of course, Jonathan Cardenas and Jesse Garrow for putting this together. And I give the floor for closing remarks to Jonathan.
Well, thank you very much to our panelists. It's really a very interesting discussion, and we're very grateful for all of you for coming in from outside of New York, with the exception, of course, Professor Ferrari and Mr. Shore. We're still very grateful for all of your thoughtful comments and a fantastic, really fantastic discussion. So I'd like to hand over the floor now to my co-managing editor, Jesse Giro, who I'd actually like to give a special thanks to. Without his really dedicated help over the past 10 months, when we've been putting this together, it would really be impossible to have had this kind of event. So a special thanks to him and to our panel. One more time, thank you very much.
I'd like to echo Jonathan's thanks. You should know that Jonathan is a real mastermind behind all of this. He's the one who got all of these fantastic speakers to come join us today. So I have really enjoyed the discussion today. I hope you all have as well. Thank you so much for joining us. And I want to extend our thanks to all of the panelists who've joined us today for sharing their expertise with us. So I'm not going to say anything too substantive. You've had enough of that, probably. I just a few quick things. I wanted to remind those of you who are seeking CLE credit that we need to have the feedback forms filled out for you for you to receive CLE credit. And please do remember to check out as you step out. I did want to mention that we invite you to learn more about the journal on our newly launched website, which is nyujlb.org. So please check that out. And just a plug for an upcoming event that's actually somewhat similar to this one. The law school's Environmental Law Journal is hosting an event 2 weeks from now on the 15th on renewable energy finance, and that may be of interest to some of you. And you can feel free to email us if that's of interest. So now I'd just like to invite you to mingle and stay with our reception. Thank you so much.